This is totally not planned. So we're just going to have a chat without coffee.
Well, I'm glad we didn't talk in the beginning. Let's just start. So we're starting now.
Yeah, let's go.
We're good? Yep. Episode 30. Welcome, KT Confidential. And today we have Mat Piche, also known as the Fruitful Investor on YouTube, joining us. Mat, thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me here.
We always like to start just by having our guests give us their background. So What's your story? Where'd you come from? How'd you end up where you are?
Yeah, so I guess a quick story about myself. I started off in carpentry. So right after high school, I did my apprenticeship in building houses in carpentry. I kind of knew that academia wasn't for me. Going to college or university was kind of out of the question. Wasn't really what I was good at. So I got into construction and was obsessed with flipping houses, which is the reason actually why I got into that. I wanted to be a house flipper. So I got into construction and just realized that I couldn't do it forever. So my dad was a carpenter. His dad was a carpenter. I saw everybody else around me just kind of working the typical 9 to 5 and kind of realized there's no way I could do this forever, just backbreaking labor. Mm-hmm. So I quickly started my own business right after my apprenticeship, which is about 4 or 5 years, specializing only with real estate investors. So I renovated properties for investors in Kitchener and Waterloo strictly. And the more I met with them, the more they said, Mat, I wish you were a realtor. All my realtors don't know anything about real estate investing. You already do. You know, I wish you could just be my realtor. So I kind of put two and two together, realized, you know, hey, I can't do this carpentry thing forever. I might as well kind of fill the need and be the Kitchener-Waterloo kind of real estate investing expert. So that's exactly what I did. And then things kind of started snowballing and I started buying my own properties. So I bought my first property at age 22, kind of right when I started my construction business.
That's young.
Very, very young. So I got right into it and then bought my second property right after that, which was our primary residence at the time. And that was it. I was tapped out. I had no more money, no more credit. So I just kind of did that for a bit. And then the more I built up my real estate agent business through social media and YouTube and Instagram, I started getting partners and people just saying, why don't I just partner with you? You know, you already know what you're doing. You have the whole system down. And I kind of realized like, hey, this partnership thing and this social media thing is really interesting, very new. I kind of doubled down on it and I built my entire business, both of them, my agent business and my investing business, all from social media.
Nice.
So all my partners, all my money partners came from YouTube specifically and kind of the rest is history. I'm just kind of snowballing and I no longer do construction anymore. I stopped that many years ago and now I'm just a full-time investor and full-time realtor.
Now he just wears the blue shirt.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
So one thing I can't remember where I read it, but I guess coming from your background in construction,
yeah.
I think for people that are looking to invest in real estate, especially people that are flipping real estate, having good trades can make or break it for them, right? Yeah. Like a lot of people get taken advantage of or you know, things don't go as planned. There was something I'd read regarding that, and maybe it was back when you were doing the construction stuff and finding ways to do it on the cheap or finding more affordable ways to do it. Like what would you recommend for somebody? How do you find a good tradesperson, good reliable people?
So that is the number one hardest thing with real estate investing. Literally, the contractors are the number one aspect of your business that's going to make or break, like you said, or screw you.
Yeah.
It's not your realtor. It's not your mortgage broker. It's not your lawyer. It's going to be your contractor. So finding a good one is very important and it just comes with practice. Thankfully for me, I was a carpenter. I was in the industry. I kind of knew what to look for in people when I met them, but I got taken advantage of a couple of times, but it really just comes down to trial and error and practice. And more importantly, to kind of avoid all that is networking with other real estate investors in your target area and getting their contractors. So once you find a good one, which can take a while, but once you do find a good one, my advice is to keep them busy. So I have a crew that pretty much almost works for me exclusively all year round. I keep them busy with all of our projects, which we're buying like one or two properties a month at this point, all my clients' projects. So I keep them busy all year. So they pretty much work for me and I just kind of grab them and hold them.
Yeah.
So it took a long time to find them and now I just keep them busy.
Well, that goes back to you are always talking about specializing. Specifically like geographically. So that works well with that because you've got the same trades working in that same area.
Exactly, yeah.
People start to spread themselves thin if they have to go search for people in areas they don't know.
For sure.
So that's a big one.
So let's get right into a couple of meat and potato questions for you specifically. Kitchener-Waterloo area is booming.
Yeah.
A lot of people looking to invest there with all the growth and still quite affordable.
Yeah, definitely.
And a lot of options to purchase and either flip or hold for a short period of time or whatever and profit that way. A little bit more difficult in an area like Milton where where you're paying almost $800,000 now for an average home.
Yeah.
But in your day-to-day activities, you're searching, and you have the benefit of being able to see all the listings,
yeah.
and you've got it from A to Z. If you're out today, Matt, looking at properties to purchase for yourself to flip,
yeah.
what are you looking for?
So to flip specifically, it's almost impossible to flip in Kitchener off MLS. So almost like GTA here in Milton, pretty much the same thing, I would assume. So finding flips on the market is almost impossible. You'll never make it work. The numbers are too high to purchase. So you have to find flip deals off market. So you need to find motivated sellers and get to them before the realtors, us and me included, get to them. And that comes down, yeah, that comes down to marketing. So I do a lot of marketing for like Facebook ads and Google ads and specifically flyers to buy those deals before they hit the market. And that's kind of the secret, because with flips, obviously you want to buy low, sell high. That's kind of the term for that. Whereas with buy and hold, you know, if you have a long-term strategy, you can still pay market value today. Just buy a good property, wait 5-10 years, you're going to be a winner on every single one, almost, in Kitchener, Waterloo, GTA, Milton, for sure. So there's a different strategy for flipping and buying holds.
I agree. I think that as the portfolio grows as well, that you do have to have a little bit of balance, a little bit of mix.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, offset some smaller gains with
yeah.
some other larger gains.
For sure.
Yeah.
What's your favorite type of investment? Would it be flipping, yeah. single family, multi-residential?
So single family, long-term investing is my bread and butter. That's what yeah. I built my whole business, my whole net worth on, I guess. I love those because they're easy, they're boring, it attracts the highest quality tenant in real estate. So it's just nice to build that wealth in the background. So I've kind of built that stage of my business now. Now, at this current time, my primary strategy is flipping. So what I teach my partners and clients and people watching me is to build the wealth aspect of your business first. So buy all your buy and holds, focus on that. Once you have kind of that wealth system there, then turn to getting rich, which is flipping, active income, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the strategy I kind of promote, is to play chess, play the long game. So get all the wealth now, and then once you have a good base, then switch to flipping. Whereas a lot of people want to do flipping right away on their first deal. It's sexy. They see it on HGTV.
Everybody talks about
yeah, it. It's
yeah.
Honestly, probably the wrong strategy for most people is to start off with flipping. It's a very advanced and veteran strategy, I would say.
I relate it to going to a casino, because everybody thinks they're walking
yes.
into the casino and going to win, right?
Yeah, for sure.
But it's actually quite timely that we're having Matt on the podcast, because we just purchased a property this week, and we have no idea what we're going to do with it.
Nice.
Yeah, it was an interesting one. It was undervalued.
Okay.
On MLS.
Significantly, it was on
Sweet.
MLS. And I don't know. It's tough.
It's one of those that, because we are so in tune with the local market,
yeah.
That we know it's undervalued.
Yeah.
But for that listing agent, and probably for many other realtors selling into our trade area,
yeah.
they would have no idea unless they were in the grind
exactly.
for that kind of property for a while. So we probably bought it for somewhere between 8% and 9% below market value.
Nice. Yeah.
But we have no idea what we're going to do with it, whether we're going to flip it or hold it and
yeah.
and see where it goes from there. But
it's good to have options.
Yeah. From a rental standpoint, what have you found? Have you had any struggles, or do you have any suggestions for people that are renting out properties, but they do want to sell them, but maybe the properties need some work, or they could use some freshening up to,
yeah.
you know, kind of capitalize on the market and get as much money as possible?
So you're saying, like, what's the best strategy to get a quality tenant, you're kind of saying?
No,
or
let's say, well, for example, this house that
yeah.
we've just got, and we decide to rent it out.
Yeah.
But this particular home, it was a nice one, in our opinion, because it needs some cosmetic updates. It
yeah.
doesn't need them, but they would make a significant difference. So
sure.
paint and floors.
Yeah.
So we could rent it out for a year, and maybe the market's better at that time. We want to sell it.
Yeah.
We can't kick the tenant out.
Yes.
Technically.
Yeah.
Legally
to
do that. So what are your suggestions with that? Like, are there ways to motivate people to leave, or what?
Yeah. So the best way to get someone to leave is to pay them to leave.
Money.
Right. Yeah.
I've had yet a tenant say no to like $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 to leave.
Yeah.
So there's always a way.
Yeah.
Mostly.
Yeah. So there you go.
Assuming
buy
it's
out.
In the budget.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. Yeah, plan for that. Yeah.
Otherwise, well, if you're sitting on the property for a few years, it probably is.
Yeah. Yeah. You'll make it up. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think most people, if you've done your due diligence and have the proper tenant in there, and you come to them and you say, hey, this is where we're at right now, but I want to help you. Here's your first and last month deposit on your new place. You know, most people will say, well, I don't want to leave, but with that kind of incentive.
For sure.
And then if they say, no, thanks, I like it here, you have to go to some other
then you go higher.
Measures that we can't talk about.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's where that really big plumber that you know comes in handy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Toilet's leaking.
Yeah.
Any Airbnb stuff?
I don't do any personally Airbnbs. I know a lot of my clients, a lot of friends who do that. It's a different type of business. So for me, I like the passive, boring, you know, my lifestyle. I love to travel and have a boring business.
Yeah, we're going to get into your Bali trip.
Yeah. I've been wanting to talk about that.
Fucking bastard. Coming in here all tan right off of a long trip like that.
Yeah. So that's kind of what I focus on.
Your wife is involved with your business.
She's starting
as well?
To get more involved. Yeah. So she
is
finds
she a licensed realtor?
No.
No.
So that's something we're thinking about.
Keep
kind
it that
of.
Way. Come on.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Much easier. So she does. She finds all the deals for us. All the properties for my clients, my partners. She's the one who does all that. I'm kind of the one out there attracting the money, putting deals together, selling deals to clients. That's kind of what my focus is now.
Nice.
Yeah.
Let's talk about your trip.
Yeah, it was incredible. Nice and hot. It's good.
Yeah. It's quite cheap to once you're.
Oh
there,
my God! It's insane the amount of value you get. Like each year, the houses we were staying in are about $150 a night Canadian. But if that were here, it would have been easily $800,000 a night. Like it's insane how far your money goes there.
Wow.
And food was incredibly cheap. You know, we could get a whole meal each for $7 Canadian. And it was like a huge meal that would cost $30 here. Crazy.
Surfing?
Yes, tons of surfing.
I'd love to do that. That'd be fun.
Favorite part of the trip?
The surfing, for sure. Yeah. Beach. That's what I'm all about. Relaxing, beach,
I saw one
surfing.
Of your posts, you got a little scraped up on some coral maybe?
Yeah, that was my friend.
Oh, your friend.
Yeah, he got scraped up coming out. Yeah.
Yeah, it looked pretty bad.
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
Yeah, I had that happen once. I wasn't surfing. I was surfing in a kayak, if that counts, on a vacation. Coral's not fun.
No.
It hurts.
Not at all.
So.
You never been there before?
No, that was the first time in Bali, yeah.
So I've seen that you've been to Hawaii and Cuba and Mexico. Yeah. Was that your favorite
Bali was for sure my favorite in terms of landscape and nature and value for what you get. I wouldn't necessarily want to live there. Mm-hmm. So my favorite trip all around, I guess, would be Costa Rica. That's somewhere I would live tomorrow. That's where we're planning on living. It's right up there with the number one pick to retire soon. So Costa Rica is for sure my favorite for the like the well-rounded. Super safe, has everything that like the Western countries like us have. It's hot. It's nice.
Great place cheap. For Canadian realtors too.
100%,
my brother's in-laws, they're realtors up in Muskoka.
Okay.
In Huntsville.
In the summer.
And then they're working in Costa Rica.
That's amazing.
In the cooler months. But yeah, my brother and sister-in-law go to Costa Rica usually for 2 to 3 months every year.
Yeah.
And they rent a place. I don't know how much they pay, but it's next to nothing compared to here.
For
so
sure.
They rent a place for, monthly and they love it there.
It's amazing.
And, I think one thing people are often concerned about is medical stuff. And,
yes.
I think it was my sister-in-law, she had to get some dental work done. So if I'm not mistaken, the dentist flew in for her specifically to perform some surgery or whatever. And then flew out and it was next to nothing.
Yeah, it's so cheap.
Crazy.
Yeah.
They actually have great medical attention there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of Canadians there. There's
a lot
of Canadians there. So there is money now floating around to keep amenities and services and all of that. I love Costa Rica. I was there a few years ago. I think if somebody wants to invest outside of Canada, that's a
number one area. It's pretty up there, yeah.
Great. Well, that leads into one of the questions that came in yesterday about investing outside of North America.
Yeah.
And
well, they brought up Turks. If Turks and Caicos ever becomes a province of Canada, then
just don't invest in Panama.
Yeah.
I have a bad story about that.
Oh, no.
I got fucked over.
Damn.
But anywhere else is probably good. So it's especially, I think most of those probably short-term rentals.
Yes.
So you, that's the problem where if you're not there, you need the connections to service everything.
Yeah.
So.
But that's the problem anywhere.
For sure.
Like even locally, but like my condo in Florida, it was impossible to just manage it being so far away, even though it's a 3-hour flight and or a phone call or an email, but and different countries obviously are operating differently, so you just have to be so in tune and have somebody available to be there if something goes wrong. Yeah. I think I don't know if you were reinvesting in real estate in another country, where would you invest?
I couldn't say.
You?
I personally only invest in Kitchener and Waterloo in Canada. So that's for
me. It stays true to his specialty.
Yeah, very specialized. I've almost invested in Costa Rica, very close. And then I just kind of said, you know what? I'm just getting too emotional. You know, it sounds sexy. It sounds cool. Yeah. I'm not the Airbnb guy, you know, the super active business income. I like the passive. So I just stuck to my guns and stay here for me. But it may make sense for a ton of other people. I know a bunch of investors and friends who do it, making really good money, way more money than long-term buy and hold, but more headaches, more management, more phone calls, more emails. I like it. I don't want to know the tenants. I just know every first of the month, all the rents get deposited every single time on my properties. Cool. That's what I like.
Better to make a lot of money here and then just spend it vacationing.
Yeah.
Well, now you've mentioned that too. People need to figure out what sort of lifestyle they want.
Yes.
Because
for sure.
Depending on what they invest in, they could be setting themselves up for something they just do not enjoy
100%
at all.
That's something a lot of people ignore. They just watch the TV shows. Like I said, they get wrapped up in money, money, cash flow, cash flow. Cash flow is king. We hear that all the time. No, it's not. It depends on what you want, right? Like my property is only cash flow $100, $150 a month max on my single families. Everybody's like, you're an idiot. Why are you buying those? They make no money. Well, 5 years, 7 years later, I look like a genius, don't I? They all appreciate it. They're all getting paid down every single month. It's great. That's what I like.
Well, we had this exact conversation a couple of days ago about the property we just bought. You don't have to make money every month.
Yeah.
In fact, the condo that I had here in town was losing money every month. And when I sold it, it turned into a magnificent deal. Mm-hmm. People aren't taking into account. Yes, you'll have your principal and interest payments in a mortgage, but that principal is getting paid down and the rate of appreciation. So if you have that strategy, you're going to hold it for 5, 7, 10 years.
For sure, yeah.
Some people will argue that it's a good idea because you're gambling that homes will continue to appreciate and you're hoping. And we've seen in the past that things did change at one point in 2017 where it went crazy. And some people got screwed over. Now they're stuck in their houses for a while.
But are they? Because if you look at today's prices across the MLS, and I don't care where you are, Kitchener, Waterloo, Hamilton, Toronto, the prices are not that far off.
Yeah.
No, I agree.
What they were at the peak of 2017. Yeah. So 24 months later, and you have recouped what you quote unquote lost, right?
So maybe. I mean, it depends on what you did with it. If you bought it as an investment property and it was a second property that you wanted to rent out or something, and now you've been stuck with it for 2 years, or maybe you wanted to flip it and it was a bad flip, obviously.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, the nice thing with real estate and with stocks in general is if it drops, you just hold on to
just
it.
Just wait,
You know, don't cash
you only
in
lose when
money.
You sell, right? At the bottom, so
exactly.
Just wait if you can.
Yeah, makes complete sense.
Let's answer this other question. I want to buy multiple properties. How does one leverage mortgages to do that? And this is from Lakshman PR. I want to buy multiple properties. How does one leverage mortgages to do that? I think the first answer is...
Well, start bank or broker maybe.
Yeah. I mean, you need to have a good mortgage broker for sure.
Yeah.
That's the epitome of any kind of real estate investing, I think. But back to Matt's point, I think you've got to start by having that foundation of 1, 2, 3 properties that are your buy and hold properties that maybe you've put that 20% into it and you can leverage the equity on those for multiple properties in a few years' time.
Yeah.
Would you agree?
Yeah. So the foundation is super important. And then to buy multiple properties, I guess he's asking, how do you buy 4, 5, 10, 20, et cetera? So a lot of people get stuck in Canada about 3 to 5 properties. That's kind of where the max amount of mortgages you can get.
Lenders will say, uh-oh. Yeah.
Yeah. Which makes no sense because you've proven yourself as a savvy investor. They're making money. You've shown you can do it over and over again. But now you're seen as a risk. So if you own 5 properties, you're actually, it's negative, you know, rather than owning 0. Mm-hmm. The person who owns 0 is going to look better to the banks, which makes no sense. So if you want to own more than 5, 7, 10 properties, what you're going to have to do most likely is joint venture with other people who don't have any properties who can get the mortgage in their names. And that's kind of exactly what I do. So my partners have to put up all the money to buy the property. So to buy a down payment, renovations, all the money and get the mortgage in their name. I then run the deals. So I can literally buy unlimited amount of properties because I'm not on title. I'm not on the mortgage. We just have a joint venture agreement off title. Nobody knows about it. And that's how you can buy multiple, well over the 3 to 5.
Yeah, that's a good idea. And then they're like a silent partner.
Yep, silent partner, yeah.
Yeah, that's nice. That works well. As long as the bank's not watching right now they know your strategy.
Yeah, exactly.
don't tag them in this
yeah.
one.
Yeah. So cool. I've always had a draw to multi-residential. I don't know why. It's always appealed to me. I think part of it is I've always watched Grant Cardone.
Yes, Grant Cardone.
I assume you're familiar with him. So maybe it's just him like hitting my head all the time. Yeah. It's like, this is the way to go.
Yeah.
So that's always appealed to me. I know it's probably higher maintenance, but something like that's probably,
I see that in my future. I'd be up for buying an apartment building.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We just need a few million dollars.
Maybe we'll find one in Kitchener, Waterloo.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I saw one.
There's a joint venture right there. All right. If you were, for those listening that know Kitchener, Waterloo area, and we won't talk about Guelph, Cambridge, those areas too, because I think they're booming as well for investors. But any specific areas that you think people might want to focus on without giving up your secret sauce?
Like other than Kitchener, Waterloo, Cambridge?
Within Kitchener, Waterloo.
Yeah. So what I tell my clients is, number one, Waterloo is out of the question because of the rental license. So in order to be a landlord in the city of Waterloo, you have to have a license. It costs on average about $1,000 a year for the average single family home. So it makes no sense to invest there unless you're doing student properties. Then it makes total sense. Keep doing that. That's cool. But let's just go over to Kitchener, Cambridge, which is right next door. No rental license. Great areas. So Kitchener itself, there are very little bad areas, almost none. You can almost buy anywhere in Kitchener and you'll win. Cambridge is a little more spotty. There's a certain areas you want to avoid and then a bunch of areas that are great as well. So you need an expert, kind of plugging myself here, but you need an expert.
You worded everything perfectly. Yeah. It's like
I've said it a thousand times.
Some great areas, but there's some terrible areas. Yeah.
So not going to tell you which ones. Feel free to click the link below.
Yeah. And it's like that in, you know, so many places, like even in Milton, there's little pockets of areas where there's more opportunity than others.
We've been doing a fair amount of business in Cambridge and Kitchener. I love Kitchener. Yeah. The downtown core and anything that's in walking distance to some of the older areas as well. I think over the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to see a huge increase in demand.
For sure.
Kind of reminds me of, what happened in Halton and Peel region over the last 20 years is kind of happening over there
Yeah, there's a lot of money going there for the tech industry, but the downtown specifically in Kitchener was always like a no-go, like don't ever go down there. And then within 5 years, they've been putting a ton of money trying to catch up to Waterloo, because Waterloo is kind of like this future city compared to Kitchener and Cambridge. Yeah. And Kitchener's kind of catching up finally. So they're doing like the light rapid transit, all the new buildings going in downtown to kind of stimulate more growth and more money, better quality tenants.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Kitchener mostly.
In Kitchener, okay. Because when I first saw you, I'm like, you look so familiar. And I've been racking my brain trying to figure out, it's probably just because I watched too many of your videos.
But
you're the first realtor to be on the show.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Cool.
Well, aside from...
Yeah.
Third. I don't count you as a realtor. you're still just my neighbor.
Yeah, I don't know if you know that. We're next door neighbors.
Your neighbor is nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
Before we had an office and staff... business meetings were always on one of our porches with a beer in hand.
Cool.
Yeah, it was very convenient.
Grassroots,
the good old days.
Yeah.
So I watched some of your clips on Instagram, some of your posts. You got a great page, by the way. Nice following. You actually purchased some properties, seems like for a buy and hold situation, that you were getting tenants in to those properties, but you did a reno before bringing the tenants in.
Yeah.
I didn't see what the before was, so I'm assuming you bought some piece of crap house.
Always.
made it pretty nice, yeah. And then just got a tenant based on the fact that you marketed it well, it looked well,
yeah.
It looked nice. And sure. and now the strategy is to hold on to it.
Yeah. So that's what I do on every single deal I've ever done, has been a piece of crap house, fully renovate it, get a nice quality tenant in there and just wait it out.
Do you have a price bracket that you try and stay in, or is the budget open just depending on the property? How do you look at that?
For the rental budget specifically or the buying budget?
No, for the buying budget.
Yeah. So the sweet spot in Kitchener, I'm going to give a lot of secrets here. For a single family is between 330 and 370. That's a semi-detached property. That's like 80% of my portfolio are semi-detached. There's a lot of them in Kitchener. So that's the sweet spot that my clients and I stay in. And then when it comes to like duplex conversions, which we're doing a lot of right now, that sweet spot is somewhere between 390 and 450 for a detached house that we can convert into a duplex. That's going to cost about 80 to 90,000 to renovate, and it'll be worth 550, 600 when we're done. So that's where we renovate it, refinance, pull some money back out, get it filled with tenants, and then wait another 5 years and make more money down the line, right?
So on those semis at 300 and let's call it 350 grand.
Yeah.
You would put another 60 into it?
Another 30 or 35. That's kind of the budget 35. For those, yeah.
So right away, a $385,000 home at cost is turned into a $430,000 home.
Probably. Pretty much, probably around there, yeah.
Yeah. And that's what a lot of people think is, okay, now at 430, if I can sell it for 430, I'm making a profit.
Yeah.
But what they're not taking into consideration are the carrying costs, are the... compensation to the brokerages, the lawyer fees, the land transfer costs, and all of the other behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And that's assuming everything goes smoothly.
Yeah.
No hidden expenses.
Yeah. So for flipping again, going back to that, it's all about buying correctly. So I'll give another quick little tip here. The way I buy flips when I meet a private seller is a very simple equation. I take the price, the after repair value that it will be. So let's say the property is going to be worth 500 and I know that I have comps for that. So I take 500,000 and I times it by 80%. So that's the max I can pay and then minus the renovations. So if the renovations are going to be, let's say 50,000, might subtract 50,000, 350. So that's the most I can offer. And that's exactly how it works. It's a very simple equation. So after repair value times 80% minus renovations, that's the max, period.
He's been watching a lot of HGTV too, so... So you mentioned you're throwing out flyers and maybe going door knocking to source these properties. What's your success rate with that? Like if we tried to do that in Milton, people would literally tell us to fuck off and get off their property, slam the door in the face. Like, cause
happens nobody, all the time.
Nobody really does that. Maybe we should,
Well, if nobody does it, you should do it. So it's just basic flyers. My flyers are shitty. They look like that on purpose. So the shittier, the better, because I want to stand out from the realtor flyers that, you know, we all kind of send out. So they're all colorful. They're all nice. So I want to stand out. So it's a basic piece of white paper and it just says, dear homeowner, I want to buy your house, cash. I buy 3 to 4 homes a month in this area, which I do. Call me, basically. It's very simple. Then they call me and I go there and meet them. And then I just kind of give them the price, just how I did that calculation. Very, very simple. And most of the time, I do get told to get out of here because my price is way too low.
Yeah.
But that's just how it has to be. I'm not paying market value, you know, because everybody expects, you know, this crazy price, right? Everybody's not dumb. They know the market's doing really well in Kitchener. So when I go in there and I offer them $350 and the house next door sold for $470, you know, they're like, get the fuck out of here. But I'm looking for somebody who's motivated, who's got some issues. You know, they're going bankrupt soon or they just want to get out.
Is there a certain demographic that you find typically works?
So kind of like the first time home buyer area. So I'm not really flyering like nice areas because those people are probably a little more savvy. You know, they have money most likely. That's why they're living there. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking for that kind of first buyer area. In Kitchener, Waterloo, prices, you know, 400 and under. That's kind of what I'm looking for. So I flyer those areas.
It makes a lot of sense because there are a lot of people not only that might be in distress, have financial issues, maybe they're separating, life changes,
for sure.
medical issues, whatever, there's also a lot of people that just don't want to deal with going through the process.
Yeah, that's the number one client I get. So I haven't had people yet who like are bankrupt or, you know, have motivations like that. Almost every single one I've bought off market has been just that. They just hate realtors. They don't want to do that whole process.
That's when you don't tell them you're a realtor.
Yeah, and it's funny because I have to, by law, I have to. Yes, and I do tell them and they don't care. So that's kind of funny how that works out. But they just don't want to go through the open houses. They don't want strangers walking through their home. They don't want their neighbors peeking in. And they just want a quick, private deal, no sign on the line. So that's kind of, I guess, I should focus on those people more. That's kind of been my target market.
So for those listening, if anybody in Milton wants to sell a home off market, we will cut a check today.
Yeah.
And if anybody wants to sell in the Kitchener area,
we're buying.
DM Matt right away. Is it at the Fruitful Investor?
On Instagram, just at Mat Piche.
At Mat Piche.
Yeah.
P-I-C-H-E.
Yeah, YouTube.
M-A-T-P-I-C-H-E.
Yeah.
We will tag him in, all the posts. What else did we want to talk about today?
Any questions come in on the live? No. Oh my goodness.
It's a beautiful Friday.
Yeah,
it's,
I know.
It's during lunch hour. You think people
everyone's still hungover from the game last night.
Yeah.
Did you watch it?
No.
No.
You know, I don't pay attention to sports. Every half hour I would just say, hey Siri, what's the score of the Raptors game?
When did you get back from your trip? You're still a little tan.
On Monday. So 4 days ago.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Who takes care of things when you and your wife are away?
For business wise, so I have an assistant kind of takes care of the things, but I'm on email all the time. I'm always working, dealing with stuff, always.
That's the nice thing with it is you have the flexibility of doing things wherever you are.
You have to enjoy this business. You have to be willing to work 24/7, 365. You guys know you have to be a certain kind of person.
Yeah, I'm terrible with taking vacations. Even now that we have this team and if one of us leave, things are still running smoothly. So I need to bite the
chill
bullet
out.
And take my wife on a vacation before she leaves me.
Well, you're going to get some cottage time in. That's a nice...
Yeah. I don't really count that. I mean, go away. I haven't touched a beach since February of 2013.
Wow.
Long time.
That is a long time. If you like to touch the beach.
Yeah.
I do.
Some people don't like to fly or go away.
That's true.
To each their own.
To me, going up to the cottage is a lot more relaxing than going south now because, well, you're there in 3 hours and you just throw your bag inside and away you go.
Yeah.
Going south, I can disconnect. Going north, I cannot.
You're still in Canada, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, at least have the option of it.
For sure.
So we'll see.
Well, we really appreciate you coming to Milton to be on the show today. I think the next time we get together, we're going to have to come out to Kitchener.
Yeah, maybe, for sure.
Take a closer look at
some of my properties, some of my projects. Yeah,
what you guys are doing. How many properties are you at now for yourself?
24 now.
And out of the 24, how many are you on title?
6 or 7, somewhere around there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And those are getting to the point where you can probably leverage those.
For sure.
Good,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Which we haven't yet, but they're there. Yeah.
Have you considered any other areas other than Kitchener to invest in?
For me, not really. I've looked around. I already live kind of in one of the best areas to invest in, so let's just focus there. If I didn't live there, I would have to look, you know, outside my area, but it's a great area, so why go outside of it?
Yeah,
as long as there's still opportunities.
Yeah, tons of opportunities, finding deals every week, literally.
What's the population in Kitchener right now?
So between Kitchener, Waterloo, and Cambridge, which is pretty much just one city, it's about 550,000. So more than enough. It's a big enough population to have a business.
Yeah. And there's still a lot of construction.
For sure.
A lot of land.
It's growing up insanely.
I can't believe the amount of new construction going on.
It's crazy.
There are some good opportunities, I think, with that too. Do you?
Yeah. That's something, again, I don't get involved with, like pre-construction. Don't really get involved with it too much, but there is a ton of opportunity for that. I just like the buy and hold physical asset today. I can see it.
There's a risk of who knows where the market will be when you close.
Exactly, yeah. And kind of where we're going, you know, I think we're kind of headed into a recession in the next couple near future. So I like to buy something today that I can hold on to. And
Yeah. You just opened up a
big
can of whoop-ass.
I did.
Why do you think that?
We have to. It's way overdue. Way overdue. It's been the longest bull market ever in history. So party has to end. And I'm hoping for it, honestly. So I'll say that. I can't wait.
Because you're hoping to buy more properties.
Can't wait. Yeah.
Well, that's interesting you say that, because my next question was going to be, you're tied into 24 properties, 600 title yourself. Mm-hmm. Market crashes. There's a recession. Mm-hmm. Prices pull back. Maybe you're in the negative now with some. Doesn't scare you at all?
Doesn't scare me, because, again, you only lose when you sell in the shitty time. So if you can hold it. But for Kitchener Waterloo, you know, Milton, GTA specifically, I don't really think we're going to get like a crash like maybe other areas in Canada. I think it's just going to slow down and relax, which is what we want. The bidding wars, I'm getting sick of it. Like, it's just fucking insane. I just want that to stop, right? So that's what I think is going to happen when the recession, if the recession
finally
does come.
Finally, we're getting somebody swearing on this podcast other than me.
Do you get a lot of bidding wars now?
Oh, it's insane. Every house. Yeah. Every single family house, it's a bidding war. It's just like stupid people, honestly. I can't wait for it to just end.
And here it was unheard of for almost all of last year. And then this year it started up again, not consistently, but actually pretty frequently now.
We had to slow down too. We're kind of slow down a little bit and then right back up again. So it's like, please.
But that's the average price in Kitchener Waterloo area.
Yeah. Much lower.
Is less than half
for sure
than what it is here.
Well, the nice thing now with the, when we're in multiple offers is it's not ridiculous. Like, people are you're still getting, you know, you might get four or five offers and four of them are under asking still.
For sure,
it's not, you know, insane.
Yeah, we're not seeing that still.
No, so you could still buy, you know, within reason. So
I just miss negotiating as a realtor, as a buyer. Like, now it's just all in firm. Yeah. There's no negotiating anymore. It's just like the point of being a realtor. Like, I miss the negotiation, right?
Yeah.
So.
Well, we both come from the automotive industry, so we were selling cars for years. So that's, you know, in our blood, and we enjoy that too, for sure. That's a fun part of the business.
Depends what side you're on.
True. The sellers love it.
If you're on the selling side and you're just getting, you know, four or five offers come in and they're firm and above asking and whatever.
For sure,
I mean, you can squeeze that lemon and get a few extra grand for your clients, which we do all the time.
Definitely,
but it's not like it was five whatever years ago where you're really sitting in front of the buyer, the seller, and, going back and forth.
There's nobody on your ass going to scoop up the deal and steal it from you at the last second, like shit like that, right?
Yeah. I hated that.
Wow, cool.
Thanks for coming, man. Is there anything you wanted to talk about before we wrap up?
No, that's good.
No? All right.
Talked about a lot.
Yeah,
that's there we go. That's episode 30.
thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
That's nice. Like I said...